Hello, folks. It's been a little while since I've seen you. It's been about 6-7 years now.
Yep.
October, my stars. I was trying to remember what message I gave back then. Do you happen to remember? I think it was probably Psalm 23, I believe. Could be. Yeah, I was back in those days. I was real young, had a lot more hair and all that kind of stuff. And that's probably Psalm 23. And I was thinking, well, what can I say? What can I say? And here we are again. Yeah. Well, let me lead us in prayer, and we'll go through some memories, okay? Father, we do thank you for your love and your nearness. And we thank you for the kindness that you've shown to us, even in the hard times in these last few years. Oh, my goodness. What can we say? So many smiles and so many tears and so many hard things and so many good memories. And they just all roll up into one, and then we'd come to a moment like this and we don't know how to sort out all the feelings. And that's normal. But Father, we just ask you to take our feelings and our hurts and our pains and our joys and help us to remember. Help us to remember the highs and the lows and the strengths and the weaknesses and just the human condition and all that we've experienced together as a family. And help us look up to you in these moments. For us, in the most holy name of Christ, we pray. Amen. as best I can remember, what we talked about the last time we were together was God is both loving and strong. That's what I was preaching back in those days with in funeral services from Psalm 23. That a good shepherd is both loving and strong, the two immutable characteristics of every good shepherd. And as we're continuing now with Mrs. Horton, we're going to talk more about this, maybe go into a little bit more depth. And so it'll be the same thing, just in a little bit different way, okay? And we're going to take a look at John 11. John 11. And you remember the story of Lazarus being raised from the grave? Do you remember that? Okay. We'll look at it in a little bit different light. Now, there was a man who fell ill, and his name was Lazarus. He came from a rather wealthy family. He had two sisters, Mary and Martha. And they sent to Jesus, they sent a message, messengers to Jesus, saying that this one that you love is ill, is very ill, ill to death. I'm sure that they were expecting Jesus to immediately hit the road and come to Bethany, where they were. He was only about a day away. It was about roughly 20 miles. But instead of going, what did Jesus do? He remained where he was for 2 days. Didn't do anything. Didn't go anywhere. He remained there for 2 days. And it was shortly after he started leaving that probably was when Lazarus died. Well, probably a little bit earlier than that. But anyway, let me read to you out of chapter 11, 20 and 23, these two verses. Now, Lazarus had been dead 4 days by the time he got there. Okay? So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." That's interesting. Okay? "But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" And she said, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." Jesus was relating to her as someone who is powerful. The good shepherd who has the strength to raise somebody from the dead. But that seems odd in reflection, because it took Jesus basically 4 days to get there. Doesn't that sound strange to you? At that point, Jesus looked as if, now think just a second, Jesus looked as if he had power, but he was not terribly loving, right? He has the power to resurrect the dead, but it's been 4 days that he has been not present, okay? He has been with the disciples, and they waited 2 days before he even started coming. And the way the Jewish people thought, after a certain period of time, and the soul does not fly away immediately. It takes several days for it to leave. So there he was, and Lazarus was without hope, apparently, in Martha's eyes. And here she is waiting on Jesus after she had sent for him, and he had not come. The picture that Jesus seemed to be presenting was, I have the power to raise the dead, but I didn't care enough to come on time. That didn't seem to be right. Now, verse 28. When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, the teacher is here and calling for you. And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. See, Jesus has stopped again. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise up quickly and go out, they followed her, thinking that she was going to the tomb to weep there. And when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. The same thing that Martha said. What did Jesus do? When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was greatly moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. Wait a minute now. We're seeing something different. First, we see Jesus, who apparently didn't care enough to come on time, who had the power to raise the dead, raise Lazarus even before he died, and save the whole family from all this suffering. Now we're starting to see Jesus moved in his spirit. Well, Jesus did care, right? Okay, maybe. But why didn't he come on time if he did care and he did have the ability to raise the dead? Making Jesus look a little bit, I don't know, how would you say it, incompetent? Lazy? I mean, that's not right, surely. But that's how it looks, right? Okay. Jesus, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was greatly moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. Now the Jews had come along with Mary. They see Jesus and they say, ah, we see the love of Jesus. See how he loved him. Well, wait a minute. If Jesus loved him, they didn't necessarily hear Jesus talking to Martha about, well, they didn't hear him talking to Martha about, I can raise the dead, or I'll raise the dead in the last day. All right? They were saying, well, we see Jesus' love. Where Martha was dealing with Jesus' ability, and Mary was dealing with both. And it's very confusing. Nobody knows what's going on. Now, then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb, and it was a cave, and a stone lay against it, and Jesus said, take the stone away. And they did. So when they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you've heard me. And Jesus says a prayer. And then, when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The man who had died came out. His hands and feet were bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Now, Mary was having a hard time believing that Jesus was going to raise Lazarus before the general resurrection. Right? Mary was having a hard time seeing Jesus weeping and having the power to raise Lazarus and not doing so. And the Jews who were there, a lot of them, some of them probably were believers, some of them probably were not. When they saw Jesus, they said he loved Lazarus, but They had no idea, apparently, he was going to raise him from the dead. They didn't deal with Jesus' power. What do we do with a story like this? You've got Jesus loves, God loves, and Jesus has the power, God has the power to raise the dead. You're doing the same thing. We're in 2014, we were dealing with this, and in 2020, we're dealing with the same thing. We know God is loving, and we know God is powerful, and we're here looking at Mrs. Horton just the same way we did with Mr. Horton six, seven years ago. And all of these emotions are coming up inside of us, and we're asking why. And you know something? It's all right to ask why. Jesus asked God the Father why on the cross. It's all right to ask why. Just be willing to hear the answer. We are in the middle of God's work, not at the end. We don't know exactly how this is going to turn out or how God is going to bring this to completion. This is not the end. Miss Horton had faith. You got faith in Christ. You've given your life to Christ. This is not the end. The point is, when Jesus' love and Jesus' strength are put together and he acts on both of these at the same time, he answers our prayers in a depth in a way that we cannot understand until we see it. The Jews didn't see it. Mary couldn't have understood it perfectly. Neither did Martha until they saw Lazarus come out of that tomb. It is a constant in the scriptures that when somebody asked Jesus a question or when they gave a prayer to the Lord, that the answer to that prayer or the answer to that question was bigger than that prayer or bigger than the question. We don't see it yet. We can't. We're people. Just people. Just people. I said all that to say this. God does not answer prayers lightly. They take time. They take patience. And when you feel like you can't hold on anymore, hold on anyway. We don't know how this is going to work its way out in real life. We just know that if we have faith in Christ and we've given our lives to Christ, he will answer in a way that is larger than we can expect and more glorious than we can have any reason to expect. So yes, suffer when you have to, cry when you have to, laugh when you can. But just like Mary, Martha, and even the Jews, when they went to the tomb, just hang with Jesus. Just hang with Jesus. You don't understand everything, but you do know the Lord. Right? Hang with Jesus. And he will make it worth the while in the end. And that's all we can do. That's all we can do. Let's pray. Father, take care of this family. We just go from one struggle to the next, one fight to the next. And it seems like, Lord, that at the end we just lose. We lost Mr. Horton, we lost Miss Horton. And it just seems like we lose. And it seems like The devil's got us over a barrel. Thank you, Lord, that it only seems that way. Thank you, Lord, that you are the Lord, and that your love mixed with your power, when they come together, it will be glorious. And then the answers to the questions as to why we keep ending up here will be fully answered. And we'll glorify your name. But until that day, help us to hang on to you. Hang on to us, dear Lord, and don't let us get away from you, so that we can see your glory and be the people you want us to be in word and in deed in these hard days. For us, in the most holy name of Christ, we pray. Amen.
words that have already been spoken, just say thank you for taking time of your day, your lives, to spend time together in honor of a life that touched your life. I think God pays attention to look at it for that reason. So I'd just like to say thank you for your faith in coming today. Folks, before we proceed out to the grave site together, I'd like to offer anyone that needs to just one last opportunity